and peace be unto you from God our Father, and from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text this morning is from our second reading from Colossians chapter 2, verses 12 through 17. And I would just invite you to kind of review that again as we kind of share the word this morning. Our theme, as you can see in the bulletin, is a good way to end, a good way to begin, a good way simply to be. Let us pray. Gracious God, we indeed acknowledge the glad sound of your coming, your birth, your presence, your power in our world and in our life. We thank you, O God, that once again you've enabled us to celebrate not just a birthday, but the birth, your coming. You're becoming real in our world. You're becoming flesh and giving your life on the cross that we might have the gift of everlasting life. We thank you again today, God, that we're able to celebrate and remember baptism. In the waters of baptism, you have forgiven our sin and clothed us with your everlasting righteousness. So God, I pray now that the words of my mouth, the meditation of our collective hearts, will be deeply acceptable in your sight. For you are our strength and you are our redeemer. Amen. Well, it is indeed my prayer that on this second day of Christmas, that each of you have had a merry Christmas. And it's my prayer that we truly thank God for the greatest gift of all, right? The gift of his son, Jesus Christ. The greatest expression of love ever demonstrated. So this morning as we bask a little, if you will, in the afterglow of Christmas, in the afterglow of Christmas giving, in the afterglow of Christmas dinner, as we move on to the next part of our journey, as we look back over 2015, as we look forward to 2016, as we anticipate change in our world and in our own lives, I want to invite us to pay attention to a constant, a command, a directive, a gift that comes to us in Paul's letter addressed to the church at Colossae. While we can anticipate, celebrate, look forward to a new year and new opportunities as we celebrate what God has done for us in as we anticipate what God will do and new things that he will bring to us in 2016. There is this word of consistency that enables us to handle the changes of life and enables us to maneuver successfully through the new opportunities that God gives to us. There is this word in Colossians that speaks to us. It is a word that teaches us how to approach the mistakes of the past. It is a word that encourages us and shows us how to begin the new year. It's a word that teaches and empowers us simply to be who God has called us to be. In order for us, I believe, to finish strong, to conclude this year well, it's important for us to remember who we are and how we made it to where we are. Remember who we are, and ask you to think with me about our past. I want you to think about 2015, not about how much money you made, not how well your investments did, not about your promotions or raises or good grades, and all of those things are good, but how well did you make out spiritually in 2015? Did you make any commitments in 2015? How well did you? Do you have any resolutions in 2015? How well did you make out with those resolutions? Anybody make any healthy living, healthy eating commitments? Anybody have any weight goals? Did you make them? Are you a better acting person today than you were this time last year? Did you read more of your Bible in 2015 than you did in 2015? Were you as faithful in responding to God's grace and mercy in your life as God was to you? Is giving to God as important as all your other expenses? Are they all equally important? How well did you do in 2014? When you total it all out, how did God make out in your plan? How many people accused you in 2015 of being Christian, of being loving, of being forgiving, offers us an opportunity to look back and see where we are. And we meet Simeon and Anna, probably near the end of their lives. God blessed them with the promise and he blessed them with long life. God told Simeon that he would see the Savior whom God would send before he died. And Anna had been around for a minute. They had been around the temple for a little while. They had seen some stuff come and go in the temple, but they continued walking, anticipating God showing up and doing his thing in their midst. They continued believing that the promise of God would indeed be fulfilled in their eyes. They lived their life leaning forward. They lived their lives expecting God to show up. They lived their lives expecting, anticipating, believing, hoping, looking forward to the next time God revealed something to them. They lived their lives anticipating what God was going to do next, in part because they knew they were chosen. We finished this year strong, remembering that no matter what we did or did not do, God chose us. We celebrate baptism. We remember our baptism anniversary today. We celebrate the baptism of Melanie today because in the waters of baptism, God did a major thing. God welcomed us into his family. God placed his spirit on us in the waters and the world. God reminds us that he knows us by name and he has called each one of us by name. God saved us long before our parents named us. He knew our name. At the cross, he did his thing to claim, to choose you and me to be his very own. We finish strong and we live faithful lives when we know that we are chosen by God. Saved by Jesus Christ and kept by the power of the Holy Spirit because God is just that. We finish strong when we know that we've already been chosen, already been included, already been saved, we've already been welcomed, we've already been gifted and prepared for the journey that is before us. We are chosen. Look around and see who is here. Look behind you. Look in front of you. Look to the side. Pay attention to who comes in and who goes out. We have been selected by God to be his very own family. God has called us into the sanctuary. And we are his gifts. We are his chosen ones. Chosen, selected, set aside to be the sons and daughters of God. Chosen to receive the greatest gift of all, Jesus Christ, for unto us is born a Savior whose name is Christ. We've been chosen to share a message that changes lives. We've been chosen to be a part of a movement that believes that God so loved the whole world that he would not install border patrols or exile refugees. Rather, he welcomes all to come to him and find rest, peace, shalom, contentment for our weary soul. As a matter of fact, God chose us and sent his son into our world, was born in a manger, so we can get excited when we hear the message unto us the Son is born. And Paul in this text goes on to remind us of the gifts that God gives to us, that enables us to finish well, to begin anew, and simply to be who he called us to be. Paul says, clothe yourself. God offers us his clothing. I was listening to some family members talk the other day about one of their friends' experience, and it appears that the friend saw someone while they were out that looked like one of her friends. And so she approached that person and said, "Oh, I thought you were so-and-so. Your hair is just like hers." And the person said, "Oh, yeah, that's my sister. This is her hair. I'm wearing her hair today." We may find ourselves sharing items every once in a while. Paul reminds us that God shares some major qualities with us. In the waters of baptism, we die to sin, and we are raised to a new life. We are clothed, dressed with the righteousness of God. Something happens to us powerfully in the waters of baptism. We are made clean. We are brand new. We get a new wardrobe. We get to exchange. Anybody been exchanging things these last couple of days? We get to exchange some of the things about us that do not wear well, for things that look good on us and highlight the positive aspects of who we are as the children of God. You know, there are some things that just don't look good on us. A bad attitude doesn't look good on us. A jealous spirit does not look good on us. An arrogant attitude doesn't look good on us. A mean spirit doesn't look good on us. A judgmental spirit does not look good on us. A greedy spirit does not look good on us. A cursing mouth is not a pleasant thing in an experience by nature, though we have some ill by nature. We walk around in some stuff that would be a world star thing. By nature, we are naughty and not nice. By nature, we really don't care about anybody but ourselves. By nature, it's a dog-eat-dog world. By nature, I'm going to get mine, and you need to get out of my way while I'm on the road. By nature, it's either you are with me or I'm going by myself without you. It doesn't matter. By nature, it's all about me. By nature, I'm going to have it my way at Burger King and everywhere else. I go by nature. So those things are going to look good. The things we want. God is in the exchange business. That's why we celebrate baptism. When I worked at Kmart a long time ago, a manager brought in some shoes that he had completely, completely worn out. And he brought them back to the service desk where I was working to exchange for another pair of shoes. He didn't have a receipt. Now, he was a manager. He could have bought some shoes in my opinion. I didn't own this store. I didn't have to pay for the inventory. But I didn't want to give him an exchange. I didn't even want to touch his old dirty nasty shoes. I thought the nerve of this man to come and ask me to exchange those shoes that he had worn out. But the policy said, they bring it back, exchange it. I exchanged it, and he got a brand new pair of shoes. So God invites us to a great exchange as we end this year and begin another. He invites us to exchange that stuff that doesn't wear well, that stuff that wears well. He invites us to exchange that stuff that doesn't look good, that's old and worn out, for something that's brand new, His Spirit and His power in our lives. He invites us to exchange selfish pride and arrogance for a Christ-like humility. He invites us to exchange our old nature, our human nature, our selfish nature, our this is my nature, I know you don't need to tell me nature, for the mind of Christ and the attitude. We are blessed to end this year strong, remembering that we are chosen, that we are clothed, that we are dressed with qualities that are beyond our natural ability. On our own, we may not dress the part. On our own, we may even dress inappropriately at times. But in Christ, we are dressed by God. We get to dress up in His royal attire. God has laid out a wardrobe for us so that we look like who He declares that we are His. We're able to be forgiving. We are able to practice love. We are able to encourage one another. We are able to walk with each other. We are able to be family and look like family because dresses us. He clothes us with his righteousness. He clothes us with his forgiveness. He clothes us with the forgiveness that may not forget, but with a forgiveness that chooses not to remember. He clothes us with his peace and assures us that he will take care of us. He will right the wrongs. He'll fix what we cannot. He clothes us so as this year ends, as the new year approaches, we continue to remember who we are in Christ, clothed by the power of God in a one size fits all, because it's all draped in the love of God. We are chosen. We are dressed in Christ-like quality. We are dressed up to be the very one that God has created us to be. We've got a good way to end the year. We've got a good way to begin the new year. We've got a good way to exist, to be, because Christ has come in us to rest us with a peace that passes all human understanding. He has dressed us with a love that looks beyond all of our faults. He has dressed us with a forgiveness that knows no limits and a humility that focuses our attention. I don't know what we do or have done, but rather what Christ Jesus has done and is doing in our lives. And that, my brothers and my sisters, is simply a good way to end, a good way to begin, and a good way to end.